EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
Family, a prayer that we pray together is a powerful prayer. So please pray together with me our EWTN family prayer. Today we pray for gifts of prayer. Most Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we adore you, who are a perfect communion of persons. In the superabundance of your goodness, you invite us to share in your life and love, now and forever. We ask you to grant us new gifts of prayer, so that we may grow in union with you. O God, you are our God, for you we long, for you our souls are thirsting, like a dry, weary land without water. Quench our thirsts. Give us yourself through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood,
Son of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, and what I have done and what I have failed to do.
Through my
most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who in martyrdom have brought true faith to its highest expression, graciously grant that strengthened through the intercession of Saints John Fisher and Thomas More, we may confirm by the witness of our life the faith we profess with our lips. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the second book of Kings. When Athaliah, the mother of Ahaziah, saw that her son was dead, she began to kill off the whole royal family. But Jehoshaphat, daughter of King Jehoram, and sister of Ahaziah, took Joash, his son, and spirited him away, along with his nurse, from the bedroom where the princes were about to be slain. She concealed him from Athaliah, and so he did not die. For 6 years he remained hidden in the temple of the Lord, while Athaliah ruled the land. But in the 7th year, Jehoiada summoned the captains of the carrions and of the guards. He had them come to him in the temple of the Lord, exacted from them a sworn commitment, and then showed them the king's son. The captains did just as Jehoiada the priest commanded, each one with his men, both those going on duty for the Sabbath and those going off duty that week, came to Jehoiada the priest. He gave the captains King David's spears and shields, which were in the temple of the Lord, and the guards with drawn weapons lined up from the southern to the northern limit of the enclosure, surrounding the altar and the temple on the king's behalf. Then Jehoiada led out the king's son and put the crown and the insignia upon him. They proclaimed him king and anointed him, clapping their hands and shouting, "Long live the king!" Athaliah heard the noise made by the people and appeared before them in the temple of the Lord. When she saw the king standing by the pillar, as was the custom, and the captains and the trumpeters near him, with all the people of the land rejoicing and blowing trumpets, she tore her garments and cried out, "Treason! Treason!" Then Jehoiada the priest instructed the captains in command of the force, "Bring her outside through the ranks. If anyone follows her," he added, "let him die by the sword." He had given orders that she should not be slain in the temple of the Lord. She was led out forcibly to the horse gate of the royal palace, where she was put to death. Then Jehoiada made a covenant between the Lord as one party, and the king and the people as the other, by which they would be the Lord's people, and another covenant between the king and the people. Thereupon, all the people of the land went to the temple of Baal and demolished it. They shattered its altars and images completely. They slew Matan, the priest of Baal, before the altars. Jehoiada appointed a detachment for the temple of the Lord. All the people of the land rejoiced, and the city was quiet, now that Athaliah had been slain with the sword at the royal palace. The word of the Lord. The Lord has chosen Zion for his dwelling. The Lord swore to David a firm promise from which he will not withdraw. Your own offspring I will set upon your throne. If your sons keep my covenant and the decrees which I shall teach them, their sons too forever shall sit upon your throne. For the Lord has chosen Zion. He prefers her for his dwelling. Zion is my resting place forever. In her will I dwell, for I prefer her. In her will I make a horn to sprout forth for David, His enemies I will clothe with shame, but upon him my crown shall shine.
Dominus vobiscum. Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Matteum. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and decay destroy, and thieves break in and steal. But store up treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor decay destroys, nor thieves break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there also will your heart be. The lamp of the body is the eye. If your eye is sound, your whole body will be filled with light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be in darkness. And if the light in you is darkness, how great will the darkness be?" Verbum Domini. Today we celebrate the great martyrs, St. Thomas More and St. John Fisher. Both died in England in 1535. Within 9 days of each other, and they were good friends. Thomas More was a married layman with 4 children, a scholar, and the Chancellor of England under Henry VIII. Cardinal John Fisher was in his late 70s when he was martyred. He was the Bishop of Rochester, England, and he led a renewal in education in Cambridge and a great scholar in his own right. He preached the funeral mass of Henry VII. And he tutored a young Henry VIII and co-wrote a book with him defending the church's teaching on the 7 sacraments. When Henry ascended the throne, became Henry VIII, he was married to Catherine of Aragon for 24 years and had 1 daughter, Mary I, who would ascend the throne of England. But he wanted a male heir, so he divorced Catherine, and Rome did not grant the annulment for him to remarry, upholding the indissolubility of marriage. He would, nonetheless, ignore this and go on to get married or attempt marriage 6 times, beheading 2 of his wives, seeking the male heir. In March of 1534, he demanded that his subjects take an oath recognizing the succession to the throne of the offspring of his second marriage with Anne Boleyn. And this was the act of succession. Both Thomas More and John Fisher refused to make the oath, and they were imprisoned. And that was March 1534. In February 1535, Henry proclaimed himself the only supreme head of the Church of England. But the Catholic Church was no longer one church, but now you had a Church of England. And this was called the Act of Supremacy. And it's fitting, I think, that it's over these divorces and marriage, because marriage is a sign of the unity of the one Catholic Church, united to Jesus Christ, and this was being torn at by Henry the Eighth. So Moore and Fisher refused to sign the Act of Supremacy, Moore stating that I am the king's good servant, but God's first. He wasn't going to violate God's law for the sake of the king. And both were beheaded. I read in one article that there was roughly 69 bishops at the time in England. And all but Fisher took the oath of supremacy. They all fell away. It's amazing courage and strength and faith. And sadly, we see corruption, abandonment of the truth can certainly and easily enter the secular sphere of governance. With our laws do not uphold the natural moral law, the teachings that reason can give us. We've abandoned that even in many ways in the secular sphere. But even more tragically, in history, in the local church, the church herself, and Pope Francis warns of this, worldliness can enter into the church itself. That they have one bishop in England standing against the king. Thinking worldliness means like a thinking like the world, that we're attached to the things of the world. We become attached to them and we're called to sacrifice for the truth. We won't let go of this stuff. We want to keep this stuff, whatever it is, and we'll not sacrifice it. And we can think of the sexual revolution in the 60s, especially, that so infected our culture and our thinking, and sadly, I think has entered into some parts of the church, separating conjugal relations from marriage. We make pleasure the highest good. We get confused on what marriage is, what sexual morality is. We adopt a worldly approach to sexuality, not the plan that God has established for us. We need revelation to guide us when our fallen human reason fails to see the truth. I'm more convinced of that every day, that reason is there, and Ten Commandments are expression of the natural law. Marriage itself, is, we can reason that it's one man, one woman, that it serves procreation. But that worldliness that blinds us, that our seeking of pleasure, maximizing pleasure, can distort our understanding of the truth, and we need revelation to guide us. We need the church to guide us. Jesus gives us the most solemn warning today in the Sermon on the Mount, that this world is passing. We have no lasting city here. The treasures that we can sacrifice for, are not lasting. Moth will destroy them, decay, they'll be taken from us. If we focus our hearts on the kingdom, works of charity, that's the lasting stuff. That's the stuff of real value. I recently was watching some old home videos my brother has, and it was a birthday party for an aunt, and it was beautiful to see, as John Steinbeck calls, the song of the family. There was a party, people were celebrating things. But like looking at the house and the things, the beautiful house of my grandmother and all those beautiful, nice things, all that stuff has passed away. The acts of charity, of love of the family last. But sometimes we cling to the things over the more important values of charity, family, loving one another. Jesus tells us today, where your treasure is, there also will your heart be. So the challenge is for us to set our heart on the Lord, on His teaching, what He's told us is valuable, what He has told us to focus our life on. So it's good to question our focus, because fallen human nature, we get attached to things, worldly way of thinking serves myself, my selfishness, my own pride, my ego. So, what treasure are we accumulating? Things? Guys are great at toys and activities, right? We like our stuff. Might be power, might be control, might be endless experiences. Travel. Travel's fun, it's good, it can enlighten a person, broaden their mind and things. We can also make an idol of that, even. With Instagram, we can capture every experience that we have and make a god of just endless experiences and stimulation. Certainly, entertainment and just the seeking of pleasure, these are all hallmarks of our culture. And all this stuff is passing. Even the most exciting experiences we've had in our life, it's passing. It's not the experience, even spiritual experiences, is not God Himself. You know, that relationship and that focus on God needs to be primary. It's a constant temptation for us to put something else on the throne of our hearts. The saints bear eloquent witness to making the kingdom of God first, willing to sacrifice even their lives, you know, under the greatest of pressures, against the kingdom, against God. May we have the faith that these martyrs have and the courage to live it in the world today. Let us bring our petitions to the Lord, trusting in His love and mercy.
For our Holy Father, that He may be blessed with the gifts of courage and integrity and increasing witness to Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all nations may come to know the glory and freedom of the children of God and live in lasting peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and the poor, the weak and the dying, that the Lord may be their comfort and refuge in the midst of suffering, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the faithful departed, that the Lord will receive them into the light of His eternal kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty God, ruler of all things in heaven and on earth, listen favorably to the prayer of your people and grant us your peace in our day. We make our prayer through Christ our Lord.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all the soul of the Church.
Receive, Holy Father, the offerings we bring in commemoration of the holy martyrs, and grant that we, your servants, may be found steadfast in confessing your name through Christ our Lord. Dominus vobiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo,
suorsum corda,
habemus ad hominum.
Gratias agamus, Domino Deo nostro, truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For the blood of your blessed martyrs, John Fisher and Thomas More, poured out like Christ to glorify your name, shows forth your marvelous works, by which in our weakness you perfect your power, and on the feeble bestow strength to bear you witness through Christ our Lord. And so with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end, we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, Deus Concedi et Vena, Gloria Tua.
Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered in your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mysterium fidei.
What am to annunciamus Domine, et tua resurrexit.
celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. John Fisher and Thomas More, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you, and your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow in the world all that is good. Per ipsum et cum ipso et in ipso, est tibi Deo Patri omnipotenti, et in itate Spiritu Sancti, omnis honor et gloria, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Recepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere.
Pater noster, qui es in cenis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua,
Quaesimus Domini ab omnibus malis, da propitius pacem in diebus nostris, ut opae misericordiae tui reduti, et efficatio simus semper liberi, et ab omni perturbatione securi, expectantes beatam spem, et eventum salvatoris nostri, Iesu Christi. Christi Apostolis Tuis, Pacem Olimpo Vobis, Pacem Eamdo Vobis, Neris Vigias Pecata Nostra, Set Vitam Ecclesiae Tue, Eamque Secunda Voluntatum Tua, Pace Picaria Quod in Arde Dignetis, Qui Vivis et Regnas in Secula, Secula Ordo. Pax Domini sit semper vobis cum.
Tecum spiritu tuo.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
reward from God. They died for Christ and will live forever.
For those who cannot now receive Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, we offer the following prayer. O Jesus, I turn toward the Holy Tabernacle, where you live hidden for love of me. I love you, O my God. I cannot now receive you in Holy Communion. Come, nevertheless, and visit me with your grace. Come spiritually into my heart. Purify it, sanctify it, render it like unto your own. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Amen.
Quod est in hoc libro?
us pray. O God, who in your holy martyrs have wonderfully made known the mystery of the cross, graciously grant that drawing strength from the sacrifice, we may cling faithfully to Christ and labor in the church for the salvation of all, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
De gratias.
O Christ Jesus, I acknowledge thee, King of the universe. All that has been created has been made for thee. Exercise upon me all thy works. I renew all my baptismal promises, renouncing Satan and all his works and pomps. I promise to live a good Christian life, and to do all in my power to procure the triumphs of the rights of God and thy church. Divine Heart of Jesus, I offer thee my poor actions in order to obtain that all hearts may acknowledge thy sacred kingship, and that thus the reign of thy peace may be established throughout the universe. Amen.
For centuries, Catholics have made pilgrimage to venerate the saints, trekking hundreds of miles, or praying before the relics embedded in parish altars. We venerate these servants of God who magnified the Lord in their lives, who gave nothing less than their full obedience, and in times of adversity, their lives. Their sacrifices not only allow us to practice our faith today, their writings shape our faith, and more so, they provide us with something for which we all strive, a sense of purpose. Lead children of an all-powerful and ever-loving God, God who is charity, meaning sacrificial love, himself, are called to holiness. We are given graces, joys, and sufferings to glorify the Lord and to serve his people. We are purified through penance and nourished by the Eucharist. We look forward to the joys and challenges ahead. We are one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. From adversity, through charity, to eternity.
Say as he hung on the cross, Father, forgive them because they know not what they are doing. He prayed as a man, and as God with the Father, he heard a prayer. Even now, he prays in us, for us, and is prayed to by us. He prays in us as our high priest. Prays for us as our head. He is prayed to by us as our God. Christ was indeed only once immolated in person, yet he is immolated every day for the people in the sacrament or in holy mass.
Friends, one thing for certain that mercy always calls us to be is other-centered, as opposed to the opposite, which is being very self-centered. Great illustrations of this truth are found in the 14 works of mercy, which are geared toward the other to aid them. These are the 7 corporal works of mercy for the body, and the 7 spiritual works of mercy for the soul. And let us not forget the many saints whose lives show us the way of being other-centered. For example, St. Vincent de Paul, with his work for the poor and disenfranchised, St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, with her work of educating the young, St. John Bosco, with his work of aiding orphans and helping them develop trades, and St. Mother Teresa of Calcutta, who founded the Missionaries of Charity to serve the poorest of the poor. Some of my favorite quotes from saints in regard to being other-centered are the following. Pope St. John Paul II tells us, "The giving of oneself brings with it an enriching of oneself." St. Catherine Laboure, the miraculous metal seer, teaches us one must learn to see God in everyone. St. Peter Chrysologus, an early bishop and doctor of the church, says, "If you don't close your ear to others, you open God's ear to yourself." And St. Jean-Marie Vianney, the holy curé of Ars, states very eloquently that no one ever heals himself by wounding another. So friends, let us really strive to be other-centered as opposed to being self-centered. And let's ask the saints to show us the way. I'm Father Wade Benizes of the Fathers of Mercy for EWTN. Thanks for tuning in to the wonders of His mercy.
Hello, dear ones. This is Jim.
And I'm Joy.
And we're the Pintos.
speaking with you about the sanctity of marriage and the family, and the good news of the power of the Holy Spirit that is in our lives, that we might manifest the fruit of the Holy Spirit. The fruit of gentleness, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, his gentleness, is beautiful and it is sure. In the original Greek, this word for gentleness spoke about wild animals that now had been broken or trained so that they could be used by human beings, so that they could live around human beings or be in their homes and their dwellings and function properly. In the spiritual sense, human beings need to be spiritually domesticated, that we would be able to be around God and his way and relate to one another in marriage and family as we should. We don't own one another. We treat one another with respect. We all belong to God. We are sacred. We are to be not only good with one another, but gentle with one another. God is almighty and he's powerful, but he's also gentle and lowly of heart. Where do we get this from? The Holy Spirit who dwells within us and his fruit of gentleness in our marriages and in our families.
Our prayer should be, Lord, teach us to be gentle, that we would look like Jesus. You know, the potter and the clay. The clay is not telling the potter what it should be. The clay is allowing the potter to shape and mold and to create it into what it was made for. As a wife and as a mother and as a daughter of Jesus, every day I surrender my will to the will of God Almighty. In my marriage, I surrender my will to that of my spouse, that together we would surrender both of our wills to the divine will of the Holy Spirit, that our marriage would be gentle, lowly, and meek, and kind, and good, and faithful. And we cannot do this apart from God. And so we invite you to participate in the process more and more every day of surrendering to the power of the Holy Spirit, that you and I would live the life that God called us to live.
Maybe we're trying to create one another in the image that we desire. But what we need in our marriages is to come together as couples and say, Lord, you're the potter, we're the clay, and stop making one another in the images that we desire. Same thing with our children. Say, Lord, who are these kids? Who are these grandkids? You're the potter, Lord, and they're the clay. And we want to bless what you're doing. So let us be gentle, let us be pliable, warm clay in the hands of the Lord. May your marriage and your family be blessed today.
This week to calm the crisis at the U.S.-Mexican border. Will it stand up in the court and keep immigrant families together? Former Speaker of the House.
And a spirituality that was doing away with what was dusty and obsolete and leading to a new joy in the redemption. Dogma was conceived, he writes, not as an external shackle, but as a living source that made the knowledge of truth possible in the first place. The church came to life for us above all in the liturgy and in the great richness of theological tradition. We did not take the demands of celibacy lightly, he writes, but we were convinced that we did well to trust the church's experience of many centuries and that the deepest reaching renunciations that she required of a man would bear fruit. And they still do bear fruit in the life of celibacy. well as readings of the fathers of the church occupied him, and they took on even greater significance when he was introduced to the theology of the French Jesuit Henri de Lubac, who later would become a cardinal. His writings enhanced Ratzinger's whole view of theology and faith. De Lubac tried to move from a strictly individualistic look at the faith to a more social look at faith, one in which a person's personal faith was part of our faith. It was part of a larger picture of faith, a faith that affected history as a whole, not merely affecting individuals. Ratzinger then became so enamored of de Lubac's thought that he sought out more and more of his writings. He was particularly moved by a work called Corpus Mysticum, the mystical body, a work providing him a view of the Eucharist that influenced his future writing. Well, Joseph Ratzinger and his brother George Ratzinger were ordained to the priesthood in the Cathedral of Freising, Germany, on the Feast of the Apostles Peter and Paul, June 29th, 1951. He was assigned ever so briefly to be a curate in a parish in Munich, and then he was allowed to go to study, and to study for what became known as his habilitation degree. The habilitation degree is a degree which will ultimately allow a man or a woman